Previously on Good Thing, Bad Thing. Professor Flannery, the Russian, sniffing glue. Communism. No, baby. Sex machine. Russia. Big Canada. Russian. Tetris. Balderdash. Vodka. Law. Viking. Rurik. Rus. Kiev. Hooligan. Nevsky. The Tsar. Ivan. Great. Ivan. Terrible. Peter. Great. Catherine. Horse. Nicholas. Stupid. Some other stuff. Rasputin. Frozen. Revolution. Compromise. World. War. Debacle. Disastrous. Crisis. Salad dressing. Chapter 4, Marx.
Can you sleep on your stomach with such big buttons on your pajamas?
No, not that Marx. This Marx. This fucking guy. Honest to goodness, if I could go back in time and murder just one person in all of history, it wouldn't be Adolf Hitler, it wouldn't be Judas Iscariot, it wouldn't even be Bruce Springsteen. No, it'd be Karl Marx. This one goddamn egghead is responsible for more human suffering than all the most terrible conquerors put together. And though the Romans, Mongols, Assyrians, Aztecs, and Zulus all rapaciously conquered their neighbors, none of them dared to rewire humanity at the point of a gun. The thought had never crossed anyone's mind until this bearded prick came along. And just what are you hiding behind that beard anyway? Why don't you be a man and show your chin? Oh God, what have I done? Marx racked up a pretty impressive death toll for a man who sat at a desk and wrote treatises all day long. I mean, I sit at a desk and write treatises all day long, but you don't see anyone lined up in front of a brick wall on my account. Let's do a quick comparison, shall we? Vietnam. A civil war ensues between two nationalist factions who should have been united but weren't because half of them were communists because Karl Marx wrote his stupid communist manifesto. Total deaths, 1 to 3 million. China. A civil war ensues between two nationalist factions who should have been united but weren't because half of them were communists because Karl Marx wrote his stupid communist manifesto. Total deaths, 20 to 40 million. Nazi Germany. A vile madman rises to power in Germany in response to the communist menace after the First World War, and all because Karl Marx wrote his stupid communist manifesto. Total deaths, 40 to 60 million. Now, who have I ever killed? Why, no one, there was that one neighbor boy, always whizzing by on his blasted skateboard, and look, my eyes just aren't what they used to be. I mean, I'm pretty sure I missed him. Definitely sure I did. Probably just a pothole anyway. Total deaths, zero, I think. But all that's besides the point. You see, while Russia was fitfully modernizing and industrializing, way over on the other side of the continent, a very hairy man was putting the finishing touches on his epic monument to human imbecility. He called it Das Kapital, which of course is German for the Kapital. And it was his best attempt to explain how modern capitalist economies function. If you really want to know, and I don't know why anyone ever would, you would be much better off reading the works of the great Adam Smith, David Ricardo, or Alfred Marshall. Karl Marx himself was not an economist, but rather something of a brilliant and eccentric essayist. One with a decidedly progressive worldview, a spiteful personality, and a tendency to get kicked out of any country he lived in for more than a few years. German by birth, Marx began his career as a promising student at the University of Berlin, where he fell into an esoteric social circle known as the Young Hegelians, a gaggle of brainy little creeps who worshipped at the foot of the philosopher Georg Hegel. Now, Hegel was perhaps the most German and most metaphysical of all the late great German metaphysicians. His most notable contribution to human thought was his description of the dialectic, which goes something like this. Knowledge is produced when a thesis collides with its antithesis and thereby produces a synthesis. Clear as mud, right?
Why, a four-year-old child could understand it.
Dialectic.
Run out and find me a four-year-old child. I can't make head or tail out of it.
How about an example? Plato proposes the earth is flat like a pancake. Aristotle proposes the earth is round like a bowl. From the dialectic between this thesis and antithesis, we arrive at a synthesis and end up with a world that looks something like this. Any of that make sense to you?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I thought it was kind of bullshit.
Smells like balderdash to me. But believe whatever you like. Anyway, the young Marx toys with this concept while working as a journalist and pamphleteer for various left-wing publications. First in Germany, until he was expelled. Then France, until he was expelled. Then Belgium, until he was expelled. Then Germany again, until he was expelled again. And finally in England, where he produced his most famous work and resided until his death in 1883. I've always found it amusing, but also revealing, that the originator of communism did so while living in the most capitalist city of the most capitalist country in the world at the time. The opposite scenario is all but unthinkable. Say what you will about Marx, he really believed in this stuff, scribbling away penniless for most of his life until he was brought into contact with Friedrich Engels, another German expatriate living in London who was rolling in dough from his father's highly profitable and extremely capitalist textile business.
All the jokes can't be good. You've got to expect that once in a while.
Engels' financial assistance enabled Marx to expound upon his theories ad nauseum. But it must be pointed out that neither Marx nor Engels, taken together the fathers of communism, ever did an honest day's work in the entirety of their historically regrettable lives. Contrary to popular belief, Marx and Engels did not invent socialism. What they did was concoct a framework for interpreting history. Marx adapted Hegel's concept of the dialectic into something he called historical materialism, which claimed socialism would naturally emerge as the next phase of civilizational advancement, only to be replaced in turn by its successor, communism. But before we jump too far down into the rabbit hole of Marxism, it might be helpful to first examine plain old socialism,
boogie, boogie, boogie,
which has been around in some form since at least the days of ancient Greece. A version of socialism was famously put into practice by various sects during the Protestant Reformation, most notably the Anabaptists until they were massacred, and our own beloved pilgrims until they very nearly starved to death. But what precisely is socialism?
Follow me, man! Never mind the men, just the women!
Oh, Chapter 4, Interlude 1. Socialism. I have been reading lately that the number of millennials and Zoomers identifying as socialists has skyrocketed in recent years. But what exactly do you mean by that? If you mean you're in favor of free healthcare, free housing, free education, and so on, this may be wise or foolish policy, but it is not, strictly speaking, socialism. It's not free either, but since when have you little retards cared how much things cost? What most of you really mean by socialism is merely an expansion of the welfare state or some reparation scheme rooted in grievance politics. But this would hardly please your genuine socialist who, strangely enough, are becoming harder and harder to find. You used to run into these people every so often, say at parties or at work functions. There you are, just minding your own business, when who should creep up behind you but the insufferable office know-it-all, blathering on, as usual, about the labor theory of value, the deficiencies of the free market, the efficacy of central planning, and so forth, like some goddamn wind-up toy from the seventh circle of hell. Do you kids know anything at all about those things I just mentioned? No? Then shut your fucking mouths. You're not socialists. You're just confused. Not that I blame you, really. These are confusing times. Frankly, it's almost sad, almost, to observe just how low socialism has sunk in the last few years. Critical gender theory, critical race theory, radical feminism, intersectionality. It's fair to think of these things as watered-down, bargain-bin Marxist ideologies. They have none of the intellectual pedigree of their forebearers. They make no claims of predictive power. They indicate no solutions to the problems they supposedly identify. They are, at best, obscure and mischievous academic exercises. The intellectual equivalent of scrawling mustaches onto great works of art, the products of decidedly lesser minds. But hey, they're buy one, get one half off, so get in while the getting's good, I guess.
Quick point of privilege. Quick point of personal privilege.
Yes. Privilege. Point of personal privilege.
Very brief point of information.
Point of clarification in that...
Point of information.
Point of privilege.
There was a previous point of privilege about waving around signs.
Point of privilege once again.
Please do not use gendered language.
Everyone who is not a counter, take a seat. Take a seat. Take a seat so that we can count.
Vote after vote after vote and voting on whether we're going to vote on voting. It is ridiculous.
Could someone please run a mic to the comrade in the jean jacket?
It wasn't always thus. There was once a time when pure, unalloyed socialism seemed to millions of people as the wave of the future, the inevitable terminus of man's long ascent out of darkness and ignorance. Your generic run-of-the-mill socialist argument runs like so. Given that human beings are communal creatures who must closely cooperate to survive and flourish, all economic activity, therefore, ought to be directed by some enlightened authority for the good of the whole. While details vary, these are the two key features of any socialist scheme. The common ownership of all or most property, and the deference to a central plan for how that property should be deployed or consumed. These features also constitute the twin rationales for socialism. On the one hand, the achievement of perfect equality and material well-being, and on the other hand, the formation of a more rationally ordered society. Ergo, you tend to notice two distinct kinds of socialists. Those motivated by feelings of envy or resentment, and those motivated by a desire for greater systemization, often conjoined with a general antipathy towards freedom and a pronounced contempt for the common man. You know, those smug, aloof types who like to drone on about high-speed rail or whatever. Unfortunately, political parties across the West have been steadily incorporating socialist ideas into their governing philosophies for over a century. This has resulted in many people, who would not ordinarily regard themselves as socialists, regurgitating socialist rhetoric almost by reflex. For example, have you ever heard someone proclaim universal health care to be a right? Universal health care may be a good use of government, or it may be a poor use of government, or it may be a mixed bag. But to call it a right is fundamentally illiberal. And yet, people do it all the time. And when you point out its socialist origins, those same people may grow angry with you, say you don't know what you're talking about, and kick you out of the little wine club. Not that I even wanted to be a part of it anyway. That was Gladys's idea. She's always coming up with these harebrained schemes to get me out of the house for God knows what reason. The worst by far was when she cajoled me into taking up jogulating. What a stupid fucking hobby. I don't understand. You just run in circles, and then talk about running in circles with other people who run in circles. Some people even hook themselves up to these futuristic torture contraptions and jogulate that way. It's ridiculous. For Christ's sake, my ancestors didn't scrimp and save and sacrifice all their lives just so that I would expend needless amounts of energy every other weekend. It's tantamount to pissing on their graves. Jogulating. What a goddamn disgrace. Anyway, the main impediment to socialist reasoning is the stubborn notion of private property.
Get off my lawn.
It turns out that most people are rather attached to their property and would not like to see it taken away from them. Socialists respond by claiming the very concept of property is itself illusory and should be abandoned. Take land ownership. Where does that come from? Well, it's not exactly clear. If you walk to an uninhabited place, put a fence around it, and call it yours, is that all it requires for you to own the land? What if, before you got there, someone else had been there but then left? Which claim should be honored? Does the land in some sense belong to everybody? And if it does, how do we decide who can benefit from it and to what degree? And if it's true that everybody owns everything, how can anybody really own anything? Wait a minute, I'm getting confused. Let's back up a bit. Even if someone can own land, how much of the land can you own? Can you own everything buried beneath it? And how far down exactly? All the way to the center of the earth? Do I own this? Is this mine? Or how about we go in the other direction? How much of the sky above you do you own? All of it? None of it? Surely some of it. Surely you could tell your goddamn neighbor to stop flying his aggravating gizmo over your house. But can you demand the airlines not fly over it? Can you demand no satellites pass overhead? These entirely valid questions about property have led some to conclude that the concept itself is fictitious. In my view, these sorts of people have done a good amount of pondering on a difficult question, and then either given up or, as is more likely, arrived at an answer that satisfied their personal dispositions. Property is not illusory. It is observable even in the animal kingdom. No person or animal can claim to own the twigs that fall from the trees, yet the mother robin, when she collects the twigs and weaves them into a cozy nest for her little hatchlings, will defend that nest from all encroachment. It's almost as if one could say, she owns the nest. And why not? Nobody else was using those twigs. Nobody else had claimed them. They were just lying there on the ground, but once she plucked them up and wove them together, the mother robin transformed the twigs from valueless debris into something useful and therefore valuable. This is the mistake that honest socialists, to the extent such persons exist, routinely make. Although the exact boundaries of property rights may be ill-defined and unclear, this does not automatically render the concept as bogus. Property is nothing more or less than the products of our labor. It is labor transmuted into some durable and transferable form, and yes, this applies to the land as well. To deny property is to deny that someone owns their own labor, or rather that they own themselves, and if you do not own yourself, who does? And here's a question nobody seems to ask. Why this excessive concern about property in the first place? Why do socialists assume that universal harmony will break out the moment property is abolished and we are all made equal? There's a lot more to life than just property, you know. There's a lot more to life than just property, you know. Of course, man requires shelter and food and the basic necessities, but beyond that, most of us don't require or desire all that much. Sure, who could say no to a bigger house or a flashier car or even a more reliable one? But in my observations of other human beings, the happiest moments seem to come from spending time in the company of friends and family. And you can do that just as easily poor as you can rich. You just have to avoid being an asshole. After all, there are many ways in which human beings are unequal. Wealth is but one of them. And there may be another area of life which, for most people, is far more important than all the material comforts you could possibly name. I am speaking, of course, about love. Now, don't get all sappy on me. This is still an educational program, goddammit. As we all know, some people are, for any number of reasons, unlucky in love. Some people go through one rocky relationship after another, which in comparison to others in more stable circumstances can seem dreadfully unfair. Some people enjoy happy marriages, but have strained or difficult relationships with their children, which can cause just as much emotional strife. Then there are those unfortunate souls who never find anyone at all. Perhaps they were born with significant disadvantages, or otherwise just plain unsightly and unpleasant. Perhaps there is no outward problem except a run of extremely bad luck. Whatever the case, it is inarguable that in the game of love, there are winners, and there are losers. Now, is any of this fair? Would not the world be a better place if there was less inequality in romantic and sexual outcomes? Well, I, Professor James O'Flannery, propose a solution. I call it sexualism, and let me tell you all about it. Oh, you're going to love this. ¶¶ In my proposed sexualist society, no person would enjoy love or sex any more than any other person because the state would take full control of everyone's romantic lives. Just like socialism, but for sex. How would this work in practice? Well, I have a number of schemes worked out. Scheme number one. I call this one the Prussian model. Every citizen will be assigned one primary romantic partner, one secondary romantic partner with optional homosexual upgrade, and 3 to 4 mandatory hookups per year until age 35, decreasing to 2 to 3 thereafter. For some of you, this may mean far less sex, and for others, much, much more. Scheme number two. Now this is the Nordic model. Every citizen will be issued a gratification card tracking their romantic and sexual fulfillment throughout a given year. At year's end, any citizens who have enjoyed more robust romantic or sexual lives must pay a luxury tax in the form of forced conjugality with citizens who have fewer check marks on their gratification cards. Scheme number three. This is the Japanese model. In this scheme, all consensual sex between 2 or more human beings is formally abolished. Instead, hyper-intelligent sexual robots will be provided by the central government, which may or may not also be replaced by hyper-intelligent sexual robots. Although this may lead to the extinction of the human race, one thing we can be sure about is that if we're all dead, then we all are, in every sense of the word, equal. No matter the details, the point is, ordinary people can't be trusted to make these kinds of decisions all by themselves. They're much too short-sighted. They just can't see the bigger picture. And so, that's why we need a central committee, staffed with highly credentialed experts, to plan, manage, and harmonize the sexual life of the nation. Sorry, Stacy, I know you've really got the hots for Chad over there, but there's a whole pack of incels desperate to get their rocks off. So when you go, have fun, you crazy kids. You too, Chad. Don't argue with me, young man. You're going to have hot gay sex, mister, and you are going to like it. Now, if all this sounds absurd to you, incompatible with every known facet of human nature, that's because it is. People can't help who they're attracted to or who they meet at a given time or place. There is indeed something random and unfair about it, but goddammit, magical and beautiful also. So why should perfect equality in economic matters seem any less ludicrous than perfect equality in romantic ones? I mean, you tell me. Some people have this weird notion that humanity is like a great big family, which is such a load of balderdash I don't even know where to begin. Humanity is really billions of individuals pursuing their separate interests and only rarely coming together for things like genuine national emergencies. And you know what? That's perfectly fine. For Christ's sake, we are not a goddamn beehive. Nor can we be made into one, except possibly through forced genetic engineering, and by that point you just gotta ask yourself, are you sure you're on the right side? Chapter 4, Marx, continued. In 1848, inspired by the attempted revolutions in Paris and elsewhere, Marx and Engels published their Communist Manifesto, which outlined their basic theories. According to Marx, history proceeds in a dialectical manner in which the thesis, antithesis, and synthesis are manifested through class struggle. Throughout the centuries, says Marx, these classes develop in contraposition to one another, leading to an eventual revolution in which the old class hierarchy is shattered and a new one takes its place.
By hanging on to outdated imperialist dogma, which perpetuates the economic and social differences in our society.
To cite the Communist Manifesto's own example, feudalism was a state of affairs in which the ruling class, the nobility, oppressed and exploited an underclass, the peasantry.
I thought we were an autonomous collective.
You're fooling yourself.
Some of whom rebelled against the nobility and after a revolutionary period emerged as the new ruling class, or what Marx termed the Borgosios. In the current stage of historical development, says Marx, the Borgosios oppresses and exploits a new underclass whom Marx calls the proletariat. In the not-too-distant future, says Marx, a revolutionary vanguard will overthrow the Borgozios, seize the means of production, and establish a dictatorship of the proletariat while society transitions to socialism.
We take it in turns to act as a sort of executive officer for the week.
Yes.
But all the decisions of that officer have to be ratified at a special bi-weekly meeting.
Yes, I see.
By a simple majority in the case of purely internal affairs.
Be quiet!
But by a two-thirds majority in the case of more...
Be quiet! I order you to be quiet!
Then, after a few more years, communism will finally emerge like a beautiful butterfly breaking out of a disgusting, repulsive pupa.
Caterpillar into chrysalis, or pupa.
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 Shut up! Will you shut up? Ah! Now we see the violence inherent in the system!
The state will wither away from each according to their ability, to each according to their need, and on and on.
Blah, blah, blah. Blah, blah, blah. Blah, blah, blah. Blah, blah, blah. Blah, blah, blah.
No offense, but it sounds like some fucking commie gobbledygook.
Now, some of you may be wondering, what is the difference between socialism and communism? Well, communism is a theoretical state of affairs in which human beings will behave in the manner of hyper-productive zombies, automatically directing their economic activity in accordance with some kind of general will, without any need for state supervision whatsoever. Sounds like oodles of fun. 'Cause that's the devil. Of course, it goes without saying, communism has never emerged anywhere at any time. Just throw that onto the huge pile of things Marx was wrong about. Was Marx ever right about anything? Maybe alienation. That's it. His entire is patent conjecture from start to finish. But Marx did pull off one great rhetorical trick. On the one hand, he asserts that communism is inevitable and inescapable, and on the other, he insists an elite vanguard of professional revolutionaries are required to midwife it into being. You can just imagine what kind of demonic personalities would be attracted to such a proposition. One cannot fail because the revolution is inevitable in any case. Any number of setbacks can be disregarded or ignored because every setback is merely one stage in the dialectical development of the revolution. I can't think of a single theory better suited to the mental habits of sociopaths than this one. So it should come as no surprise when a sociopathic Marxist eventually appeared to put the rubber to the road, shall we say, in a high-stakes, high-octane cannonball run straight to the gates of hell. Let me tell you about Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov. Let me tell you about Lenin. Chapter 5, Lenin. No, not that Lenin, this Lenin. Vladimir Lenin, who, believe it or not, was an even bigger prick than that mop-headed harlequin who lived in a yellow submarine with his hideous girlfriend and sang about strawberry eels coming together, or some such tomfoolery. I never paid much attention to any of that beetle-skeetle-hokum, or any popular music in general. That is, until that one time my dentist overdosed me on nitrous oxide. Like so many Marxists throughout the years, Vladimir Lenin was born into a comfortably wealthy family of teachers. A wild, precocious, but vengeful child, Lenin renounced his belief in God when his father suddenly died. When his older brother was executed for attempting to assassinate the Tsar, Lenin renounced his liberalism, and when he broke his comb before a hot date, Lenin renounced his hair. Throughout his life, Lenin would go on renouncing things, because that's just the sort of man he was. In his younger years, Lenin was that guy doing push-ups while reading a dictionary for hours at a time. Later, he switched to those old-timey triangular weight things and replaced the dictionary with Marxist gibberish. After his schooling, Lenin matriculated through a slew of Marxist associations both in and outside Russia, without once ever holding a real job, might I add, where he first met a kindred spirit by the name of Leon Trotsky. Beginning as young rivals for editorial control over some kooky leftist publication, Lenin and Trotsky would develop a lifelong but complicated friendship. The classic depiction of their partnership was Trotsky as the brains of the operation and Lenin the balls. But modern scholarship suggests that on several occasions, Lenin was the brains and Trotsky the balls. Still, no historian or biographer thus far has unearthed evidence to indicate either party ever was the heart. The place in their chest where a heart should have gone had been hollowed out and replaced with a heavy, tar-like substance called Marxism. Thus, they tended to stoop forward while speaking and gradually grew goat horns on their foreheads, which had to be concealed beneath various kinds of headwear. These are historical facts. Before long, Lenin and Trotsky rose to the top ranks of the Social Democrat Party, the leadership of which was almost entirely in exile, again, in highly capitalist countries like Switzerland. At the 1903 party conference, Lenin and Trotsky were divided on the question of intra-party discipline. Lenin argued that the public opinions of the party members should be kept under the strict control of the leadership, while Trotsky sided with Julius Martov, a well-meaning but hopelessly outmatched socialist who argued that party members should be free to voice their own opinions. I bet you can guess who won that pissing contest. As a result, the SDs were split into two wings, a majority or Bolshevik faction headed by Lenin, and a minority or Menshevik faction headed by Martov, with Trotsky joining the latter for the time being. He and Lenin would not speak for many years. After the failure of the 1905 revolution, of which neither Lenin nor Trotsky had any direct participation, Lenin's advocacy for violent insurrection began to draw supporters. In Russia, small cells of Bolshevik agents began to openly conduct acts of terrorism, as well as to rob banks, trains, post offices, and so on. One young Bolshevik in particular proved highly adept at this disreputable work, a relatively unknown figure at the time, born Yosef Yugoshvili, but remembered now and forever as Stalin. Stalin would become one of Lenin's chief henchmen in those early days, although Lenin himself remained exiled abroad. Trotsky spent his time slipping into and out of Russia while making a name for himself as an eloquent and persuasive public speaker. He also pioneered a certain revolutionary chic that communists ever since have sought to imitate. You know, the whole black leather trench coat thing with the beard, the mustache, the crazy unkempt hair. The spitting image of an intellectual gangster, which is basically all the Bolsheviks were. He would remain, probably, the sexiest communist around until this Latin stallion blew him totally out of the water. Oh yes, Daddy. Liberate me. Liberate my filthy bourgeois home. Chapter 5, Subsection A. Glorious February. By early 1917, the Russian state was crumbling into ruin. Her demoralized armies were on the brink of mutiny, her industry strained to the breaking point, and her people starving from incompetent food rationing. To make matters worse, the ever-delusional Tsar Nicholas had decided to personally lead the Russian forces and was away at the front making a mess of things. The Tsarina was left minding the store in his absence, and boy oh boy was that a mistake. German-born, stubborn as a mule, and sullied by that whole unsavory Rasputin business, the Tsarina was about as popular as Hillary Clinton at a monster truck rally. Unless at that rally they were planning to shoot her out of a cannon into a volcano full of scorpions. Finally, in February, protests erupted throughout Petrograd. The largest and most famous of these were the bread riots, in which a quarter of a million Russian women took to the streets, demanding not communism but food for their hungry children. Much like the Women's March of the French Revolution, this dramatic episode proved to be the turning point. When women move, men will follow. We really have no choice in the matter. Just ask Gladys why we have to visit her blabbermouth brother every goddamn Christmas, as opposed to my far more sensible plan of staying at home and doing nothing. Anyway, these bread riots snowballed into what became known as the February Revolution. A little confusing as it actually took place in March, owing to the fact the Russian Orthodox Church refused to adopt the Gregorian calendar, which they regarded as yet another Illuminati conspiracy, which in all likelihood it probably is. Tsar Nicholas, in his infinite wisdom, wired the local commander and told him to disperse the crowds at gunpoint. However, unlike 1905, on this occasion the soldiers of the Petrograd garrison held their fire. Supposedly, at one moment, a young girl walked right up to a rather fearsome Cossack cavalryman and offered him a flower, which he accepted with a smile and a nod. Whether this story is fact or fiction, the simple truth was the soldiers were no longer impressed by the Tsar's authority. Most of their officers fled, some were caught and shot, but by and large, the uprising was not nearly so bloody as it could have been. It was also moving at a frenetic pace. In the span of about a week, the State Duma began calling itself the Provisional Committee and assumed control of Petrograd. Meanwhile, the Soviets of Petrograd and Moscow stirred back to life and were soon assembling into a body called the Congress of Soviets. Administrative power was rapidly draining away from the state bureaucracy and flowing directly into these new organizations. Tsar Nicholas, finally realizing the magnitude of the crisis, boarded a train and rushed back to the capital. Who knows what was on his mind or what he intended to do, for the train never reached Petrograd. Revolutionaries had seized control of most of the railway stations, so the imperial train stopped, turned around, and then stopped again. There, on March 2nd, 1917, the Tsar was informed the army could no longer support him and was advised to abdicate. Tsar Nicholas signed the papers that very day. Thus, the once imperious Russian Tsardom, the unquestioned rulers of this strange, colossal country for almost 500 years, died with the quietest of whimpers. In the end, Nicholas simply threw in the towel. Indeed, he seemed to accept his fate with a measure of contrition and dignity that perhaps goes some way towards mollifying his otherwise unfavorable reputation. All he wanted, he told his bodyguards, now his jailers, was for his wife and children to join him, which they shortly did. Meanwhile, celebrations rang out across Russia. The February Revolution had come like an unexpected bolt of lightning. Perhaps for the first time in their long history, the Russian people suddenly found themselves the masters of their own destiny. A whole new world of dazzling possibilities lay open to them. The sky seemed the limit. Without delay, the Soviets and the provisional government began to draft a new constitution. They worked together to secure the liberties of all Russians, to address land reform and working conditions, and to end the unpopular wartime measures, and everybody lived happily ever after. The end. Except that's not what happened at all. Chapter 5, Subsection B. Red October. Do you know who I really blame for all this? The Germans. If you recall, there was still a war going on. Significant stretches of Russian territory were under German control, and the provisional government wanted them back. They also, by the way, were receiving infusions of cash and food from the Western Allies in return for staying in the war and keeping half of Germany's powerful army occupied. The Germans, for their part, wanted Russia out of the war by any means necessary, and they happened to have a trump card up their sleeve. Lenin, under house arrest in Switzerland, was foaming at the mouth like a mad dog. He raged impotently as Russia began moving towards basic liberal reforms, which to him might as well have been a return of the Tsar. The German high command knew all this, and in what may be the stupidest act of government ever, shipped this rabid Marxist in a sealed train car back to Russia. Seriously, Germany, what the fuck? You have a beautiful country, you make great cars and things, but my God, are you dumb. Along his journey, Lenin composed his April Theses, which, if you're not an indoctrinated Marxist, reads like the diuretic ravings of a blithering idiot. Here are a few of his points. Lenin summed up his views with the slogan, "All power to the Soviets," which he was confident his Bolsheviks could infiltrate and control. He was right. On his return to Petrograd, Trotsky, sticking his finger in the wind, abandoned the Mensheviks and joined the Bolsheviks permanently. And you know what that means. Before Lenin found himself on the run again. As it turned out, there was a bit of a wild card thrown into this game of high-stakes flop poker, a wild card by the name of Alexander Kerensky. Kerensky was a socialist of the non-Marxist variety, affiliated with the Socialist Revolutionary Party. He also dressed up like Frankenstein one Halloween and enjoyed it so thoroughly he never took the costume off. This would later inspire Stalin's own take on communist fashion. Those weird boiler suit things, later copied by Mao Zedong and Kim Il-sung. A prominent representative of the Duma, after the February Revolution, Kerensky emerged as one of the leaders of the provisional government. He had strong support both among the Soviets and among the soldiers, whom he encouraged to form their own Soviets. In early 1917, if I was placing bets on who would wind up running the show, I would have laid my money down on Kerensky. He certainly seemed to be consolidating power, but he made two critical mistakes. First, he supported a new military offensive against Germany, which went about as successfully as all the others. And second, he failed to kill Lenin when he had the chance. He ordered his arrest, but Lenin was tipped off and fled just north of the border to a small town in Finland. Now, Kerensky was indeed a blockhead, and a bit of an aspiring dictator himself, but I've always felt bad for the guy. At that particular moment, the only way to accurately describe the Russian political situation was absolute doggone pandemonium. First of all, nobody knew what the hell they were doing. Russia, historically, hadn't had many opportunities to practice those crucial skills involved in democratic procedure. The country was brimming with factions, from monarchists on the hard right to Bolsheviks on the hard left, and all manner of useful idiots, to borrow Lenin's phrase, in the center. It never occurred to any of these factions that their only hope for stable self-government was some sort of compromise. In a game of every man for himself, all men, except one, lose. It was all Kerensky could do to keep a lid on this bedlam until the nationwide elections in November, when delegates would be selected to formally draft a first-of-its-kind Russian constitution and, hopefully, establish a permanent Russian government. This, Lenin knew, would be the downfall of his Bolsheviks, since they were sure to be outvoted by the other socialist parties. With support for Kerensky flagging, Lenin sensed it was now or never. On the morning of October the 25th, Bolshevik sailors turned up in Petrograd with a few hijacked Russian warships, and at that point, all hell broke loose. The Bolshevik fleet began firing into the city. Meanwhile, Lenin's paramilitary outfit of Red Guards hurriedly seized government buildings and stormed the Winter Palace, where the provisional government was headquartered. After securing the place relatively easily, they then went around trashing things and got hammered on 400-year-old bottles of vodka they found in the cellar. Lenin, far too brave to personally risk his life in any coup d'etat, strolled in a bit later.
Aren't you going to come with us?
Solidarity, brother!
Oh, yes. Solidarity, Reg.
By early next morning, Petrograd was entirely in Bolshevik hands. Trotsky wasted no time in informing the Mensheviks and the Socialist Revolutionaries that their participation was no longer required. Their fate was to be kicked out of the Soviets wholesale, only to be swiftly arrested and shot. Quite naturally, any supporters of the provisional government were also arrested and shot. Any former Tsarist figures, they were arrested and shot. Any soldiers who didn't care one way or another, they were arrested and shot too. Just about the only people who weren't arrested and shot were the convicted criminals of Petrograd, who were instead let out of prison to make room for all the other people who needed to be arrested and shot.
Gotham is yours!
Within weeks, similar episodes played out in Moscow, Kiev, and many other towns and cities. Still, it would be a very big stretch to say the Bolsheviks were in full control of the country, or even all that popular in the places where they were in control. Many more years of chaos and bloodshed would follow before the Soviet Union became a terrifying reality. And as for Kerensky, well, believe it or not, the son of a bitch actually made it out alive. After a long stay at the Paris Airport Hilton, he moved to New York City and settled on the Upper East Side. There he would remain until his death in 1970, having outlived not only Lenin and Trotsky, but also Stalin, whom he angrily blamed to his dying day for stealing his clothes.
Now, in Russia, a great struggle develops between dictatorship and the people who wish to restore the freedom and individual liberty.
Do you think that the present government there will last?
I am no prophet, but I know Russia, and I am sure that the democracy will win before long.
Chapter 5, Subsection C, Civil War. As crazy as the Russian Revolution was, it always seems a thousand times crazier when you realize that all this time Russia was fighting and losing a desperate war with Germany. But our two fearless doofuses had a plan. Not a very good plan, but a plan. They believed that if they could only prolong the revolution long enough, eventually, a chain reaction would sweep through Europe, toppling the imperialist governments of Germany, France, Great Britain, etc., until the whole world was ensnared in their global communist revolution. So, Lenin declared an armistice and sent Trotsky to go powwow with the Germans. At first, those monocle-wearing apes were only so delighted, but they were shortly bewildered into uncertainty by Trotsky's repeated attempts to stall the negotiations. It was one of those situations in which a competent party is so puzzled by the imbecility of their opponent, they begin to suspect it's all a clever ruse, and their opponent is really a genius of the highest order. Of course, nothing could be further from the truth. The Germans became convinced the Russians were in the midst of preparing a massive counterattack, so they broke off talks to prepare their own spoiling attack, which terrified Trotsky and Lenin so much, they came crawling back and agreed to every one of Germany's preposterous demands. This resulted in the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, which carved up Russia like one of Gladys's perennially overcooked Christmas hams. Lenin and Trotsky's bacon was only saved 8 months later when the Allies launched their final offensive of the war and defeated Imperial Germany from the west, at which point Lenin repudiated the treaty and crowed about his supposed masterstroke of diplomacy. Or, in his phrase, no war, no peace. Whatever the fuck that means. In one way, though, the dynamic duo were not entirely wrong. In the aftermath of Germany's defeat, German communists did indeed attempt their own violent revolution, which was only stopped by the arrival of exhausted troops from the Western Front. A chaotic event which inspired the political career of a former Austrian corporal, then convalescing in Munich. Any guesses who that might be? Now then, on to the Russian Civil War, and boy was it bonkers. As mentioned, the Bolsheviks did not yet fully control the country. The shock of the humiliating treaty with Germany, combined with tales of Bolshevik atrocities, inspired many former Tsarist officers and soldiers to organize themselves into a resistance. These were your whites.
Don't stop believing. Hold on to that feeling.
founders of the old Russian order. Not exactly champions of liberal democracy, but still. They were a whole shitload better than these assholes. The Reds. And what is it with red? Why did the communists pick red of all colors? Why not yellow? Or green? Or purple? Blue? Brown? Black? Orange? Pink? White? Oh dear God. Were there any great battles in the Russian Civil War? Sure, probably. To be honest, the whole thing is a bit of a confusing mess. I know Lenin moved the government to Moscow at some point, and then you had a whole bunch of armored trains. Armored trains were really popular in the Russian Civil War for some reason. After exhaustive research, I can confidently say that if you love trains, this is the war for you. What else? The Western Allies sent forces to aid the whites, to little avail, massacre of the Jews. By the whites, actually. Massacre of basically everybody by the Reds. Several million dead, famine, death, devastation. Oh, and then there was Tsar Nicholas. Almost forgot about him. Fearful that the whites might try to rescue the former Tsar, the order came down to eliminate him. And so early one morning, Nicholas and his family, including his young children, were herded into a dark, dingy cellar and riddled with a hail of bullets. So ended the Romanov dynasty. About Russian history making you want to blow your brains out? Are any of you having fun yet? Is this on? Are you still here? There really was just one bright spot in the whole sorry episode. This guy, Pyotr Wrangel. Oh, and I'm getting a note here from my producer that I should insert the following, whatever. Here it is. I don't get it. Look, never mind. Let's just keep going. If I could pick one candidate to be the tragic hero of the revolution, it would be General Pyotr Wrangel, the Black Baron himself. This absolute legend was surrounded by an aura of testosterone so potent that every nearby man was inspired to perform routine acts of valor, and all nearby women were in constant danger of giving birth to highly capable children. These are historical facts. Pyotr Wrangel symbolized everything that was good and noble and worth preserving from Imperial Russia. He was brave, honorable, cultured, and imperturbable under pressure. In the chaos of the October Revolution, General Wrangel resigned his commission and retired to his home in Yalta, where he was shortly arrested by Bolshevik agents. But Wrangel was far too manly to stay in prison for long. He escaped and thereafter joined the gathering white resistance. Now, the main problem facing the whites is that their forces were scattered along the rim of the Russian state, while the Red forces were concentrated in the center. To the northeast, Admiral Kolchak, another highly flawed figure, commanded the Siberian anti-Bolshevik army. To the south, General Anton Denikin commanded the armed forces of southern Russia, while to the southeast, Wrangel commanded the Caucasus volunteer army. Getting all three of these guys onto the same page proved next to impossible, particularly Denikin and Kolchak. Each one separately attempted to march on Moscow when they really should have listened to Wrangel and combined their forces first. Their individual attempts to seize Moscow failed, further sapping support for the white cause. There was also a lost legion of Czechoslovakians stranded in Russia for some reason, and let me tell you, those guys were fucking nuts. They seemed to fight just about everybody. Red, white, blue, green, even the Japanese at one point. Yet in the end, only General Wrangel and his southern Russian forces remained, valiantly fending off the red tide to ensure the escape of as many Russians as possible. Finally cornered on the Crimean Peninsula, Pyotr Wrangel performed perhaps his greatest deed in life, masterfully organizing the evacuation of nearly 150,000 white soldiers and civilians. Those who stayed behind were promised amnesty by the Reds, but that was a sick joke. They were all massacred in cold blood. Nevertheless, Wrangel's heroic stand ensured the survival of the white émigrés, a motley collection of Russia's former nobility, intellectuals, artisans, businessmen, and craftsmen, who went on to thrive in various small communities within several host nations. This scattering of Russian expertise and professionalism has never really returned to Russia, much to her detriment, but to the world's benefit. And as for General Wrangel, well, he survived a few assassination attempts and managed to live out his life in Belgium. A proud, though understandably bitter warrior, who nonetheless reminds us that gallantry, even in a doomed cause, always serves a purpose. Chapter 5, Subsection D. Red Terror. And here you thought I was going to end on a positive note. Boy, do you have another thing coming. Do you know who else had another thing coming? All those well-meaning socialists and assorted progressive types who stood aside as Lenin flagrantly seized power. If they expected to wield any influence at all within this new Bolshevik regime, they were in for a nasty shock. To enforce his rule, Lenin next did what every Russian ruler before him had ever done and created a secret police force accountable to him personally. He called his the Cheka, which in the churn of Soviet politics would morph into the OGPU, then the NKVD, then the MVD, then the MGB, and finally the KGB.
The NBC.
KGB.
The NBC.
KGB.
The NBC.
Which is now, by the way, called the FSB and answerable only to this guy. Though by any name, the Soviet secret police would haunt the dreams and waking lives of millions of Russians, Poles, Ukrainians, and others for generations. Marxist ethics does not exactly place much emphasis on the individual. All that matters is the advancement of socialism and communism. Anything that furthers this goal is good, anything that hinders it is bad, with little to no room for things like honesty, charity, kindness, or forgiveness. In the sinister concrete tunnels of the Cheka subterranean lairs, a new breed of cold, remorseless killers were being trained, indoctrinated, and equipped. Within weeks of the revolution, these dogs were unleashed. Against Tsarist officials and supporters, certainly, but also against Mensheviks, last Bolsheviks, and any members of the SDs or the SRs who refused to acknowledge Lenin's supreme authority. In Bolshevik parlance, these dissenters were labeled counter-revolutionaries, in accordance with another pithy communist phrase, no enemies to the left. At the same time, the entire Russian criminal code was abolished in favor of the dubious Marxist theory of revolutionary conscience. This had the entirely predictable effect of turning the cities into dens of villainy. Robberies, rapes, and ordinary run-of-the-mill murder skyrocketed until the new authorities finally found the time to crack down hard. To contain these undesirable elements, numerous forced labor camps were hewn out of the harsh Siberian wilderness, all administered by a newly minted state body called the Gulag. Afterwards, the edicts and decrees rained down fast and furiously. Gambling and prostitution were criminalized, while abortion was decriminalized and homosexuality recriminalized. A massive literacy campaign was inaugurated, while simultaneously millions of books and newspapers were branded for wrongthink and consequently destroyed. I ask you, what is the point of teaching people to read if the only things you allow them to read are complete and utter bullshit? You might as well keep them illiterate and save yourself some time. It gets worse. The workers of some factories eagerly wreck their machines and places of employment under the mistaken impression that socialism meant they would never have to work again. All of these morons were later rounded up and shot. In the countryside, the peasants who had chased away their landlords were themselves chased away by the checker, who requisitioned their lordly manors for state use, which really meant their personal use. Everybody was making up the rules as they went along. Anarchy reigned one minute and tyranny the next. Centuries of public improvements were befouled aimlessly. Beautiful old churches were desecrated. Beautiful old buildings burned. Venerable statues were torn down and replaced with grotesque monuments to Marx, Lenin, and later, Stalin. Any of this seem familiar to you? Any of it at all? Then on May Day, or International Workers' Day, or whatever the fuck it is, the Soviets organized an elaborate parade to celebrate their criminal hijinks, since we all know how much those godless Bolsheviks love their goddamn parades. Get down! A baffling new vocabulary was conjured out of thin air to describe a baffling new array of state institutions. All previous Congresses and Soviets were done away with in favor of bodies like the Political Bureau, which in Soviet speak became the Politburo. The Organizational Bureau became the Orgburo, and the Communist International became the Comintern. Party higher-ups were known as the nomenklatura. Someone who held an official post was an apparatchik. Someone who held a slightly lower post was a commissar. There were committees on top of committees on top of committees. And if any of this sounds like Lenin and his cronies were flying by the seat of their pants, it's because they were. The Bolsheviks never bothered to draft a formal constitution. Their whole government was a house of cards built on a mound of sand underneath the geological fault line. One day you could be an important member of the Congress of Soviets, only to find out the next day you've been supplanted by the Presidium of the Supreme Soviet and, well, shit out of luck, pal. Without a shred of self-awareness, the Bolsheviks had spawned a state bureaucracy so labyrinthine and incomprehensible, it made the old czarist system seem the model of efficiency. But what the hell did you expect?
And now, members of the cabinet, we'll take up all business. I wish to discuss the tariff. Sit down, that's new business. No old business? Very well. And we'll take up new business.
Now about that tariff.
Too late, that's all business already. Sit down.
The Bolsheviks, to a man, were professional revolutionaries. That's all they knew. They had next to no knowledge when it came to statesmanship, civil administration, industrial production, agriculture, transportation, maritime affairs. Basically all the things somebody ought to know about if they plan on running a country. Worse, they refused to learn. They spoke and behaved more like religious zealots than anything else. Their Bible, their Quran, was Marx. Anything you needed to know on any question whatsoever could be answered by quoting Marx. Ironically, this pig-headed amateurism might have done more harm than all the arrests and state murder put together. By imprisoning or driving into exile every industrial expert in the country, unsurprisingly, industrial production plummeted. By unilaterally canceling all foreign debts, international financing went up in smoke. Lines of credit unraveled like so many balls of yarn, forcing Lenin and his thugs to requisition massive quantities of grain and sell it abroad. This was the only means by which they could fund the government and fight that civil war we were just talking about. Next to nothing was left for the people who actually grew the grain, and in 1921, when a bad drought hit, the peasants began to starve. Russian famine of 1921 to 1922 defies description. A story here or there is all we have to convey the barest hint of what it must have been like. In several villages, there were reports of cannibalism. In many others, villagers were merely reduced to eating oxtails, horse parts, rats, grasshoppers, pigeons, and crows. Anyone caught sneaking into what were, only a few days ago, their own fields to desperately collect grain could be arrested, imprisoned, or simply shot on the spot. A massive relief effort organized by future President Herbert Hoover of the United States was rejected by Lenin when Hoover insisted the grain be distributed equally. Finally, the situation grew so severe, Lenin was forced to relent and an international effort was allowed to proceed. Let me restate that. The most bourgeoisie capitalist governments on the face of the earth did more to relieve the poverty and hunger of a nation whose socialist government was intentionally designed to rid the world of poverty and hunger. All I can say is, I hope you rot in hell. History, it would seem, has a sense of irony. Who could have guessed the downfall of the Tsar would have hurled Russia backwards into a state of abject misery more horrifying than anything in her long, morose history? I mean, Jesus Christ. The French Revolution was a barrel of monkeys compared to this fucking thing. It's a testament to the nearly mythical endurance of the Russian people that they even had a country left to mismanage. Between the Great War, the Civil War, the Red Terror, and the resulting famine, something between 10 to 20 million Russians lost their lives. For perspective, those figures represent 10 to 20% of Russia's pre-war population. 10 to 20%. Gone after only 6 years. Worst of all were the lost children. The orphans of the revolution, some of whom turned feral and even lost the ability to speak. Many others relied upon begging, thieving, and prostitution just to survive. I ask you again, of what value are all those intellectual abstractions and intricate theories if a nation cannot even feed and protect its own children? Oh, get out of my sight! Don't put that picture up again! Now surely you must be thinking to yourself, this is it. This is the lowest point, the nadir of the whole sad, sordid story. Things couldn't possibly get any worse from here, could they?
Sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is what I feel when we're together. When you're near, the rain goes, disappears, dear, and I feel so fine.